What does it take to just send something in orbit without having any aerodynamics to worry about? You know, we did that throughout the 60s. To send something to orbit and bring it back as an airplane, that's a whole other synthesis of aero and space. And we're reminded how beautiful a word that is, aerospace. Two fragments that were never brought together before they needed to. And the shuttle is the living example of what it is when aeronautics meets space exploration.
September 1976, more than 4.5 years after President Nixon signed off on its development, America's new spacecraft, Constitution, gets its first close-up before the cameras. The orbiter itself was well received by the public, but impassioned fans of a particular long-canceled television series called Star Trek wanted it called something else. They staged a successful write-in campaign, and the orbiter was renamed for the Starship featured on the show. Thus, NASA's new shuttle would be the Enterprise, boldly going as no spacecraft had ever gone before. Whatever its name, this bird still needed to prove it could fly. August 12, 1977. On a crystal clear California morning, high above the Mojave Desert, two NASA test pilots ready for Enterprise's first flight. The plan was for Fred Hayes, Jr. and Gordon Fullerton to lift the orbiter off a modified 747, then land on a dry lake bed 15,000 feet below. Columbia was undergoing preparations for the program's maiden voyage.
It's TS-1, an unflown vehicle, and those two men getting on board and flying that, trusting that the engineering was correct, trusting that the design was correct, trusting that all the safety measures were in place, to me it's just amazing.
And you just looked at it on the pad and you said, this looks like no other rocket that I've ever seen before. It's a, you know, got huge boosters, a tank in the middle, and it's got the equivalent of an airliner hanging off the side. And even though today, by today's standards, it's very common sight, we're used to seeing it, you know, by the early 80s standards, it was completely revolutionary. And to know that it really wasn't going to fly a test flight. It had flown some gliding landings, but it hadn't flown a real test flight. And the first time it was going to fly, it was going to have two people on board. It was John Young, Bob Crippen. That was a major milestone.
I remember all the talk about the shuttle in the early days, and there was such an excitement in the air because up until then, what were we doing? You know, a capsule would go up and it would plunk down in the ocean. You had to go fish it out. And now we were making a space plane. How awesome is that? You know, it's a rocket when you need it to be a rocket, and then it's an airplane when you need it and want it to be an airplane. And so what a promise for the future of the space program that represented.
When a generation accomplishes a great thing, it's got a right to stand back and for just a moment admire and take pride in its work.
Okay, Fergie, we're starting to feel pretty good down here on the ground about this one today. So on behalf of the greatest team in the world, good luck to you and your crew on the final flight of this true American icon. And so for the final time, Fergie, Doug, standing Rex, good luck, Godspeed, and have a little fun up there.
Hey, thanks to you and your team, Mike. Until the very end, you all made it look easy. The shuttle's always going to be a reflection of what a great nation can do when it dares to be bold and commits to follow through. We're not ending the journey today, Mike. We're completing a chapter of a journey that will never end. You and the thousands of men and women who gave their hearts, souls, and their lives for the cause of exploration have rewritten history. Let's light this fire one more time, Mike, and witness this great.
hold at T-minus 31 seconds due to a failure.
And NTDSC.
Go ahead.
Yes, sir, we need that to go do the verification for the LCC, please.
C-Mac, the LCC says we need to verify using a camera.
Okay, let us know as soon as 62 is flown over and you can verify LCC for GDA retract, please.
This is C-Mac, we verify retracted.
All right, and FTE?
And NTDSC concurs, they satisfy the requirements of GSC 13 pre-plan contingency, I'm go.
Yes, sir, I heard all that. Concur. Press on.
On the big loop, we have you in sight.
Excellent, we'll be there soon.
We're waiting. Houston Station, Atlantis on the big loop, initiating RPM in 3, 2, 1, mark.
Welcome to the International Space Station for the last time.
Great EVA to close this all out as the last of the shuttle EVA. Really appreciate that.
Okay, so for all you guys who've worked at Expedition 18, I'd like to announce the return of the SOX.
Okay, Mike. Mike, come in. You probably have a future in closet organization.
Hey, that's the great thing about space flight. You know, one day you're doing the most outrageous thing humans have ever done, you know, spacewalking. The next day you're fixing toilets and packing boxes.
Good evening, Sandy. Go ahead for transfer.
Okay, per all these call downs, I show everything complete in the MPLM, and it's actually chock full.
Atlantis departing the International Space Station for the last time.
Columbia now 39 nautical miles down altitude, 42 nautical miles downrange. a little hot and all your calls will be a little early. The youngest trip is really moving out now. Velocity now reading just 1,600 feet per second.
Complete, Houston. After serving the world for over 30 years, the space shuttle turned its place in history. And it's come to a final stop.
So my bias is, when I think of the shuttle, I think of the Hubble telescope. But that alone doesn't do justice to all the other satellites that were launched, deployed, repaired, retrieved. And so this is the kind of access to space that I think we all fully expected to happen. And in fact, it did.
If I think about it in terms of engineering challenge, things that were really out there, real-time planning, how did the shuttle demonstrate its flexibility as a reusable spacecraft? I'd have to focus on STS-49, where we had a problem grabbing an Inelsat satellite, the grapple fixture. Of course, the Inelsat satellite was stuck in a bad orbit, and we had to go do something about it. So we sent three spacewalkers out, unprecedented, never done that before, and they just stood in the payload bay, and they just grabbed this huge satellite, and they plugged it in, and they did all the work they needed to do to it and sent it on its way. And I think that just epitomized the flexibility of what the space shuttle is all about.
Releasing and capturing and repairing satellites to independent science missions. There was a series of missions that were held on just the shuttle orbiting low Earth orbit, where science of various kinds was done, from radar mapping to neuroscience to life science to physical science, and these were dedicated science missions. Phase one missions to Mir, where we were docking to the Russian space station Mir, having to work procedures with the Russians on how to work around their space station, and then taking that experience and translating it into, of course, the crown jewel, if you will, of the shuttle program, was building and constructing the space station itself.
I think the shuttle program will be remembered for, number one, obviously the first reusable spacecraft. The fact that these vehicles have been flown year after year, mission after mission, and you come back and look at them, it's like, it's amazing. This thing, it looks great. People at the Kennedy Space Center prepare it, service it, make sure it's ready to fly. And the care that the people here at the Johnson Space Center around the country to have a vehicle that is subjected to the environment that it is in launch and landing. Space shuttle allows us to bring the big payloads, the big large equipment and science results back down to Earth.
All of the orbiters each have their own personality, have their own sort of following, and so, you know, for the people who have worked on Atlantis for so long, I think it's special for them that it will be the last mission.
Kind of like my mental image is that, you know, NASA should be doing those things that are on the leading edge. And the shuttle has been an amazing learning tool to provide us the platform and opportunity to learn how to operate in low Earth orbit. We've learned how to assemble, we've learned how to do spacewalks, we've learned how to control the medical aspects of spaceflight, especially long-term spaceflight. We've learned a lot about just how to do things in space. We got Hubble in extremely good shape. We've got ISS in extremely good shape. Now we have other areas coming up to take over the LEO functions that the shuttle did. And what we're doing is we're sacrificing the shuttle to enable us to be able to take that next step. If we were going to retire the shuttle, this is the time to do it. And I think that we're going to just expand the breadth of things that we do as a nation and as an international partner.
And if you look at how the shuttle program has evolved, it wasn't clear when the shuttle was first built what it was going to be doing, in particular for all these different missions. It sort of grew into being able to carry out all these missions because of the versatility that was inherent in the design of the vehicle and because of the dedication and the creativity of the people who worked on the program for so long.
We're incredibly overjoyed to just have had the space shuttle for 30 years and to know that you know, we had this ability to go to low Earth orbit, and we're so much more comfortable here than we were just a short time ago.
The heart and soul of the space program is, of course, the people. The passion, the dedication, the commitment is unlike any other workforce anywhere in the world. Because of the commitment and the passion, the dedication and the hard work, the space program is successful. That you have this impressive group of people who truly believe in spaceflight and give their heart and souls to it.
So now we can stand on the shoulders of all those wonderful people that dedicated their lives to the shuttle program. By continuing to live and work on board the International Space Station and then pushing out into the solar system to explore.
Everything going smoothly. T-minus 45 minutes and counting.